My brothers and sisters, it is so good to be with you right now, and so good to be with my dear friend Mario Ensler, who has been up close and personal with so many saints that I think he's technically a third-class relic. There's grace from just touching the man. So we're going to dive into the up close and personal stories of saints on this beautiful All Saints Day. Thanks for being with us. Before we dive into the interview today, I got some exciting news. I'm a grandpa again. Let's bring the picture up on that screen so I can swoon. It's my little grandbaby. Welcome to the world, Charlotte Stefanick. She was born on my 46th birthday. That is the best birthday gift a man could ever ask for. And just contemplating the gift of this new life, just have me contemplating the gift of life in general. And what is it when God scans the infinite amounts of possible human beings? What is it that makes him draw forth the people who, from the infinite sea of people who could exist, those who get to? And I think it's something in the Father's heart and mind that just delights when he thinks of that person, when he thinks about you. And there's a good meditation to send you with this week. At the end of our show, maybe spend 5 minutes thinking about what does the Father delight in when he thinks about me? And I'm not asking you to puff yourself up in pride, but guys, thinking about that, it makes you intentional about guarding that charism and that grace that God gave you and developing it. You see, the saints all stand out from one another. I mean, people who fall into different sins, they all start to look like people in that category of sin. Sin doesn't just take grace away, it takes your individuality away. You could pick people out of a crowd who are smoking a lot of weed or who are into a particular kind of drug just by the look on their face. You could pick people out of a crowd who have given themselves over to lust. Every time they're with a woman, the way their body language is, being a saint makes you fully alive, fully you. John Paul II said this when we were at World Youth Day. This is John 10:10, my favorite scripture. I'll never forget his voice. It echoes in my heart saying it. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. The saints live life abundantly. Christian path isn't about self-negation like Buddhists. The more close we get to our God, the more we stand out and become fully us. That's the story of the saints. And here to talk about some of the saints with us, my dear friend Mario Ensler, former Swiss guard, founded a school in New Hampshire, is a teacher of business in Houston.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. I can't wait to visit the University of St. Thomas. And most importantly, dad of five.
Correct.
Well done on that.
Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord.
It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. And three kids engaged. So I think I'll be a grandpa sometime soon as well.
And I love being around Mario because he's one of the few people that makes me look tired and introverted.
I take that as a compliment.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, real quick, what is a Swiss guard and how do you become one?
Okay, well, a Swiss guard is a bodyguard of His Holiness. And to become a Swiss guard, you have to be Swiss. And
so
I am Swiss.
Not in the running.
Correct. So I am Swiss because my dad was Swiss. My mom Italian. I was born and raised in Italy, but with a Swiss passport. And when I finished graduate school, I decided to join the Swiss Army. And from there, I evolved and joined the elite Swiss Army.
And there's the man.
Yeah, that's when I used to be ruggedly handsome and I had hair.
Ruggedly
today,
handsome.
Ruggedly handsome.
I think you're still ruggedly handsome.
Thank you. But that's it. So Swiss, okay. and that's it.
So yeah. You got very close access to St. John Paul the Great.
Yes.
How many years were you working under him?
Under him, I did 3.5 years as a Swiss guard, and then I got to embark into a banking career, and I basically went back and I served as a financial advisor. Because, you know, even a pope as a financial advisor.
That's awesome.
Yes.
When did you realize that this isn't just an average guy? Okay, well, being a pope, you can presume this is not an average guy. When did you realize this is a saint?
About 6 weeks in the service, okay, I had seen him from afar, but not yet had an interaction with him one-on-one within the Apostolic Palace. And so he was notified that he was going to come through. So you have to follow a protocol, close doors, make sure that nobody shows up. Mm. And then you go into your attention. And here he comes. Here is a little secret for you, Chris. St. Pope John Paul II shuffled. You know, he didn't really clack, 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 but was more like shh, 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 walking. I think that was because of Parkinson at the beginning. You have a hard time picking up your legs. So when he came, I was so proud, and I thought maybe he's going to stop and, you know, say something. I can't talk unless he talks first.
That's
all right?
Rule.
And that's the rule. So I'm in attention, and he stops, and he looks at me, and he says, "You must be a new one." When he said that, you know, I came out of attention. I had my white glove. I took it off. I went straight with my hand, and I introduced myself. 6 seconds, 7 seconds, my name, where I was coming from. He kept my hand.
He noticed everybody.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He kept my hand. He brought his left hand, sandwiched my hand, and said, "Well, Mario, thank you for coming to serve who serves."
Thank you for coming to serve who serves.
And then he left my land, my hand, and he walked away. That's the day that I thought, this man is special. He has something that I want. I don't know what it is, but I got to pay attention because he's special. So that's it.
This isn't the world business leader who breezes past everybody working for him.
Yeah.
He noticed everybody.
He noticed everybody, yes.
I love it. He wrote in Arise, Let Us Be On Our Way.
Yes.
He wrote, I hate the word crowd. I love the word multitude.
Correct.
Because he noticed every person.
Yes.
And I'll never forget being in a crowd of 750,000 people here, you know, maybe 10 miles from this studio.
Okay. Oh, in 1993 when he came. Yeah.
Teenage kid.
Yeah.
The phenomena of feeling like I'm a quarter mile from him. He's a speck up there. And I felt like he's talking to me.
Oh, yeah.
And everybody felt that.
Yes.
There was this heart of the Father inside
Correct.
Of him.
Correct.
And it's beautiful to hear that confirmed in the way he interacted with people right. on a regular basis.
You know, being in his proximity, especially in small audiences, it was always hard for us because, you know, he will, you know, you split up the people in small groups and His Holiness will go first to a first group and then we'll go to the second group and you clear. Okay, and once I remember we were in Castel Gandolfo and I cleared and a kid, probably 5, maybe 6 years old, sneaked out and went back to him and I tried to tackle him and His Holiness saw me and he burned me with his eyes, meaning let the kid come.
Oh.
And I opened my hands and I let the kid go and His Holiness, you know, gave him a caress and then the kid came away. He never denied himself to anybody. Unbelievable.
Praise God.
Unbelievable.
Hey, listen, I want to hog you up all to myself, but if you're watching, you want to ask Mario questions or me questions, text 720-650-0100. Again, it's 720-650-0100, and we'll get to your questions. Did he regularly stop and notice you, or was that just a one-time thing when he first saw you, or did he spend time and, like, did he regularly check in on you, see how you're doing?
He did, I would say, a combination of things,
okay.
And I would say every time that he walked by me or he walked in a place where I was and he was by himself or maybe with just one or two people, he will always find those 10 seconds to come and shake hands and ask, how are you? Because he knew sometimes you are alone into this massive room for hours on your feet and he will console you. Sometime, because of protocol, he will just walk by, all right?
Yeah.
But in many occasions, he will look at you, you know, so you will go up in attention, he will come, and he will lock your eyes so that you know that he noticed you. Maybe he didn't talk to you, he didn't touch you, but he noticed you, and I will feel that. I knew that he noticed me. So.
You know, as convicting to me as a dad, I don't have a pope has a billion. He's called the Holy Father.
Right,
he has a
right.
billion Catholics or
right.
his kids in some sense.
Right.
I got 6 kids. And how often I fail to say, like, make that eye contact
Correct.
And make that person feel special
Correct.
Like they matter.
He really taught me how to notice all the people around me. And I always tell my students at the business school that you mentioned, whenever you grow in your career, whichever position, never forget to say good morning to the door person, to the janitor. You need to know who they are. Always be humble and reach out to everybody because that's what St. Pope John Paul II did. To an humble dude that I was, he found an interest in me.
Okay, before I dive into some more serious questions, I got a pretty fun one from Harrison. And I'm glad he asked this because I wonder this kind of thing. Is it difficult to stand still for so long?
Yes, very difficult. I still remember Blessed Pier Giorgio Frassati beatification in St. Peter's Square. I was the sentinel, you know, which is one of the four guards with the alabard next to the altar. The picture is very popular.
Were you trained in actually how to use those
alabards?
Yes,
you are.
That's scary.
I stood without moving for 4 hours and 20 minutes. That's hard.
That's
but
amazing.
I will follow Mass. I will sing, you know, the Kyrie, the Creed in my brain. I will pay attention. And I'm just a symbol. I'm not in security details. Mm. I'm just a symbol, okay? But God gave me the grace. And yes, then when you get off, you need a couple of beer to rehydrate yourself.
Seriously.
But 4 hours and 20 minutes, that's long.
We got to see John Paul II's great struggles.
Yes.
Not only with the culture of death and with communism, but with Parkinson's.
Yes.
And he had this, I think often about the joy of the saints.
Yes.
He had this supernatural smile, this grin that I think made the evil one very nervous.
Oh, yeah.
And the entire world and the leaders of the communist regimes that were crushing the faith in Poland. There's this grin that almost said, like, I know who wins.
Yes.
You know? You got to see him suffer in the small ways.
Yes.
With a lot of grace.
Yes.
There was one time he smashed his finger in a door that shows his holiness. Tell me that story.
So that story is, he was coming back from a week at the hospital, okay, the Ospedale Gemelli, because he had a benign cancer. Mm. And so they removed the benign cancer. And when he came back, I was in service in the Damaso courtyard, you know, where the car arrived. And he had to just walk by me to get into the elevator, all right? And I knew that he was weak, okay, and that he was probably in need of even climbing three stairs to come up from the car, and I was ready, all right? But when the car arrived, the Mercedes, this old Mercedes, nothing fancy, but was convertible, okay?
Yeah.
So when the Pope arrived, the driver comes out, and they opened the roof, you know, so that then I see him, and he looks pale, he had lost weight. He gets out of the car, and when he got out of the car, before he took the step to come up, he almost lost the balance, okay? And so he, instead of falling back into the car, he took a step, and with his back, he went against the side of the Mercedes, and his left hand went where the door was, okay? And so, not me, thank God, the butler closed the door.
You don't want to be the Swiss guard
right.
That slammed
the butler, skin. Angelo, closed the door, and his finger 5 and 4 got shot into the door, which is, you know, a bulletproof door, so heavy.
Ooh.
And they opened immediately, and His Holiness took his hand. He didn't swear. He didn't complain. He didn't judge. You know the only thing he did, Chris? He put his chin down, and he sucked it all in. That's when I realized that suffering is actually good.
Wow.
Suffering is redemptive. I don't know, but if you take your, I don't know, if you put your fingers here and I smash them with a hammer, I don't know what you will say, right?
These are, I know what I would say.
There you go, me as well.
These are stories that make me realize that I'm so not a saint.
But suffering is redemptive. I'm convinced because I saw it.
Oh, man.
And then I remember calling my mom and telling her what had happened. And I said, you have to watch the Angelus. That was on a Friday. And on Sunday, he came to the window. And he had the left hand wrapped up and the things. And so my mom knew in advance.
It's the little things that make people saints.
Yes.
See,
yes.
We often overlook the little things and think, if I can only do great things.
Yes.
If John Paul II spoke really well and drew large crowds, but was a jerk in the little things.
Right.
Not a saint, sorry. We've got a great question. My grandmother's family is Swiss. Can I be a Swiss guard? This is
well,
an American.
Does he have a Swiss passport? If he has a Swiss passport yet.
Work on the passport, and then you got a shot.
You got a shot.
Okay.
Okay,
that's awesome. You're working for the church. You wear an outfit that looks
funny,
right? I wasn't going to say it. No, but it's kind of cool, though, too. It's a medieval outfit.
Yeah.
You know, but you're also legit soldiers.
Correct.
And bodyguards.
Correct.
So there's things that go along with that you think of with soldiers who sometimes they're hanging out with their buddies and they do
right.
stupid things.
Exactly.
Or, you know, a bad word flies here or there.
Yeah.
And were you ever caught by the Pope just goofing off inappropriately, or like what happens when a pope walks in and sees guys just
well
goofing off?
We unfortunately, because we are sinners, okay, yeah. We did, as a matter of fact, and the way that we got caught, so to speak, is four of us were playing cards, uh-huh. okay, and in Castel Gandolfo, the summer residence, and me and a buddy and against two, and then my buddy put down a card which was not the card that I was expecting, and so I said a bad word. I called him a bad word, and after that came out of my mouth, the zucchetto, you know, the cap, uh-huh. arrived in the middle of our table, and we said, "What the heck?" And we looked up, and His Holiness was on the balcony. And he looked at us, and he touched his head, and he said, "Oops." There was no wind, Chris. There was absolutely no wind. So he threw the zucchetto down as a sign, "Hey, you don't need to say that." Mm. So I got caught, and I got spanked. Yes.
Yeah, now, you might be the only person I ever knew who let a bad word fly in front of two canonized saints.
Yeah,
you're setting a record here. That's
incredible. I know.
But before I get to the second saint story, yeah. Steve asks, what kind of training did you go through to be a Swiss Guard?
All right, so first of all, you have to go through 17 weeks of training in the Swiss Army in Switzerland.
Okay. So you go through boot camp, basically.
Correct, right. It's an officer school, right, 17 weeks. Yeah. And then when you come out, then you go to Rome, and you have 6 weeks of specific training, which is detail on protection, the person, you know, harms and fights and all of that, okay? And you do that part-time in Switzerland and part-time in the Vatican. And then at the end of that, you have to pass a test. And if you pass that, okay, then you enroll. And the more you acquire seniority in service, mm-hmm. the more experience, the closer you get to the Only Father. Because ultimately you swear to take a bullet for him, right?
You just said you swear.
You swear.
I've seen that.
Yes, we swear on the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And during the consecration, I've seen you guys kneel and
put that
oath up. That's beautiful.
Right.
This is almost disturbing. You actually learn how to use that halberd.
Yes, we do.
That's a gory, gruesome weapon.
Well,
man.
You need to understand, you know, as a guard, you learn self-defense.
Yeah.
We carry guns, okay, especially during the nights. But because we have that stick, as my kids call it, okay, well, you know, it's not that we do taekwondo, okay, but we definitely know how to use it.
It's a bad day if you guys have to use those.
There you go. I never really used the halberd. I did use the sword. One, okay, not that I took it out and cut somebody's ear like St. Peter did, but there was a poor man that he was kind of pushing it, and then he took a syringe out at me, and so, you know, I did not lose my temper, but all I did,
you know... You kept him back with the sword.
Right, the sword. No, I pulled the sword out, and there is like a knot on top of it, and I just pulled my sword and put the knot right there. Boom! So...
That'll do the trick.
That did the trick. That did the trick.
It's a part of Christian life people don't always like to look at. Sometimes you have to use physical force and self-defense or the defense of others. And
sometimes,
praise God,
you know,
for
Jesus turned tables upside down and I knocked a guy with the bulb on top of my sword.
That's it. Okay, so there's another good question on the screen. Yes. But before we get to that, the second saint that you that you were reprimanded by, which I got to apologize. I shared a video clip of another interview with Mario that had that many people saw, and your friends all started calling you a sissy afterwards. Yeah. I don't think you're a sissy.
Thank you. You're
the man.
Thank you.
But let's hear this story.
Very quickly, when a Swiss guard gets into trouble, all right, and so you are entitled to some social service, and for the guards, in my time, you will go to the Missionary of Charity and help out in their soup kitchen, okay? And I've been there before. Obviously, I'm very choleric, and so sometime I will push, and trouble meaning curfew. You know, you have to be back by 1 o'clock and you come back at 3 o'clock. You have 2 hours times three, 6 hours of social services, all right? And so I was there and I was washing pots and I threw a temper tantrum because the pots were not getting clean and the sister...
I do this regularly.
Right. And so when I threw the pot into, you know, the triple sink that you wash and sanitize and rinse, when I threw the pot in, water came out and got my jeans, my shoes, my underwear, and I threw a bad word, all right, out of okay, I don't need this, all right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
When I said
We've
that,
all been there.
Right. When I said that, I noticed that there was a nun next to me. And, you know, the missionary of charity, they all look alike. And so when I actually focus on her, I realized that was mother. And I had never met mother. Mm. I've seen her from afar, but never really met mother. Mm. And so when I looked mother, mother looked at me, and she told me in Italiano, but I'm going to tell you in English. She says, wow, you sure sound like a sissy. So when she said that, I almost felt like, Assisi? I'm 6'2", 200 pounds. I almost wanted to take a pat, Chris, and cover her and say, I'll prove you who's Assisi. I never done it, but, you know, she...
The horrifying moment where yes. you let it fly, and you look over, and there's Mother Teresa.
And she like, called me Assisi.
It get worse than
wow.
this.
Wow.
And then you're called a sissy. And she gave you a miraculous medal.
Right, right. So at the end of that day, she had left a little miraculous medal for me. And then I took it, and then I lost it, all right? And then almost 6 months later, almost to the clock, I was in the Apostolic Palace, and I saw her again. And I made myself a promise. I'm going to go and tell her I'm not a sissy. But when I interacted with her, rather than me telling her what I wanted to tell her, you know, she came in front of me and there were two other guards and the other two, they saw that she was coming at me, so they moved away. Mm. And she's not a priest, so I don't have to do the salute, yeah. okay? So I'm looking at her and she was very petite, right?
Yeah.
And you know how they're, you know, she had the stole here,
oh, yeah.
and she moved the stole and she took a miraculous medal off a pin that she had, all right? And I'm looking at this, and then without even knowing in a mechanical way, I went like this with my hand. And she put the medal in my hand, Chris, and she looked at me and she said, and this time, don't lose it, sissy. So first of all, how did she know that I had lost the medal? And second of all, how did she remember that she called me a sissy?
That just gives me chills, and it's hilarious at
the
same time.
This is all about the saints, they focus on people, and that's,
yes,
that's,
I mean, it's literally it's a down-to-earth yes. and mystical experience yes. of a yes. human at the same time.
Absolutely.
Is there any, when you think about these encounters with the saints, and you also got to meet Blessed Alvaro del Portillo,
yes,
who was the head of Opus Dei
correct.
After Jose Maria Escriva.
Correct. Correct.
Tell us about what his person was like. I mean, again, third-class relic here, man.
So Blessed Alvaro, Blessed Alvaro, you know, beside being Jose Maria Escriva's personal secretary,
yeah.
okay, he was an engineer, so. He really, you know, orthodox thinker, okay? But I got to know him at the Opus Dei headquarters in Rome, where they will host this open house for men. And hey, you give me food, you give me booze, you give me tobacco, I'm there,
yeah.
all right? And so I will go there, and Blessed Alvaro will just use the way, you know, the book of Jose
yeah,
Maria
yeah.
Escrivar, and he will say, oh, tonight we are going to lead only 3 points. You know, there are 1,000 points. And then he will talk, and I will just listen and say, this makes a lot of sense
oh,
to
yeah.
me.
It's a beautiful down-to-earth
You got it. Very, very
way,
simple.
Google the way.
Yeah.
Little tiny booklet. And the wisdom of the saint is so
yes.
accessible.
And he will tell us footnotes, because he was... Jose Maria, Saint Jose Maria Escriva's mm-hmm. secretary, and he knew when he was writing this because he helped him process that,
wow.
you know. And then, you know, I got to know him, and then when he was ordained a bishop in 1991, I was at his ordination. And I will never forget when we went to an event the next day, he gave me a big hug, and he told me, remember, I will always love you. And, you know, I
oh
thought,
my gosh.
Wow. I said, whoa.
How
you know,
beautiful.
I know. It's.
Beautiful.
I always thought that engineers are a little dumb, but he was quite an engineer.
right?
Probably somebody that is engineer, sorry, but that's how it is.
No, that's a place we have to not be afraid to go
correct,
as
correct,
Christians.
Correct.
I'll never forget, I got to interview Pastor Rick Warren once,
yes.
who wrote Purpose Driven Life. He never met me before, but we started the interview, he goes, have I told you lately that I love you?
Wow.
I thought, that...
Yeah.
I mean, what?
Yeah,
what?
Huh? Yeah.
And that is how the Lord approaches us,
correct,
though.
Correct.
And that's not unmanly. It's not cheesy.
No.
It's not it's touchy-feely. That's true strength.
Absolutely.
It's to love people. You know, we all, grown up Catholic, have these ideals of saints that, you know, it almost makes it, they're so holy card-ish and not human.
Correct.
That they no longer challenge us. You know what? And you got to see three people that you knew personally, that you encountered, who would have been able to say, "Oh, Mario, how's it going?"
Yeah.
Later, in your lifetime, be right. canonized or beatified.
Right.
What a gift that is.
Yes.
What surprised you about these personalities that broke through those molds of those people who are up there in a pedestal and don't really challenge me because they're caricatures of saints? What surprised you most about the personalities, the person of the saints?
I would say, obviously, a common denominator of the three,
yeah.
Simplicity.
Simplicity.
Simplicity. Simple people, extremely humble, down on earth, and they had a relationship with God that was not only authentic, but palpable. You knew, okay, mm-hmm. that whenever they would say something or they would act in a certain way, it's because God was somehow whispering in their ear, in their soul, right? And so simplicity will be my definition, because they never... How can I say? They never sat down on a pedestal saying, "Hey, come and bow to me." No, 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 no. Mm. Exactly the opposite, all right?
Wow.
And yes, there is an office, as I will say,
yeah.
but simplicity.
I'm gonna meditate on that. St. Paul tells us that we should strive for a simple
there you go.
Life. And a lot of us think, "I don't want a simple, I want to go and be a go-getter," and right. just right. more and more. And John Paul II, we talk about a complicated and busy life, and yet his spirit was so simple.
Yes.
That in the midst of the chaos of his role, he could walk past, "Oh, there's a new guy." And he knew what mattered most, and that's human beings.
Right. You know, one day I was in the third floor of the Apostolic Palace, and I was feeling a little upset because my day off had blown, you know, and so I was tired. As a Swiss guard, at my time, you used to work 100 hours a week.
Wow.
Out of 168.
Wow.
So you have 68 to sleep and
try to... No way they're going to hire millennials to do that job. No
you got
offense,
it.
No
you
offense,
got
guys.
It. So that day, I was a little sad, upset, let's use that word. And when they told me that His Holiness was going to walk by, okay, I really thought, oh, let's hope he's going to say something to me. I just want him to notice me and not being just like a tapestry on a wall, all right? And he comes, I go up in the attention, and he walked away. He didn't stop, Chris. Mm. And so I remained in attention, and I closed my eyes, and I felt so sorry for myself because I really wanted him to acknowledge my existence. And when I reopened my eyes, maybe a second and a half later, he was right in front of me.
Just looking at you.
I had absolutely no perception that he had walked back.
Mm.
And there I am in position, and he's staring at me. And John Paul II had this uniqueness. He will stare at you with his blue eyes, sometime for 10 seconds. You know how long 10 seconds are?
Oh, yeah.
That
it's
somebody
awkward,
stares
beautiful.
At you and doesn't talk. So I'm standing there, and I'm thinking, okay, what's going on here? And I noticed that he went with his hands in the pocket of his cassock, okay? And then all of a sudden, he comes out with a rosary, not this one, but a very cheap rosary. And he holds the rosary like this, okay, with his first and second finger. And he looks at me and he says, "Mario, the rosary is my favorite prayer.
Mm.
Marvelous in its simplicity and profundity.
Mm.
Take my beads." And when he said that, I came down from attention, and he put his beads in my hand. And he said, "And make them your most powerful weapon."
Mm.
So I closed this. He did two steps away from me, and then he stopped, and he looked at me, and he said, "Remember, never be afraid." And he walked away. He knew that day that I was upset, discouraged, and he stopped, and he gave me his rosary.
Marvelous in its simplicity and profundity. That sums up the saints.
Yes.
We got 30 seconds before they wrap us up.
Yes.
Please lead us in a closing prayer.
Okay.
Thank you, Lord, for the marvelous simplicity of your saints.
Okay. I would like to say, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blesses is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Saint John Paul the Way,
pray for us.
Saint Mother Teresa,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Brother, what a gift to be with you. Thank you so
much.
Guys, thanks for being with us. Don't miss next week when we're talking about how to live in gratitude and enter the joy of the saints. Love you guys.